We've been thinking all about orbits. We've thought about planets orbiting the sun and the moon orbiting the Earth. But there are some things that orbit that are actually man-made, right? We call them satellites. They cruise above our heads and will actually remain in orbit for millions of years. A very special type of satellite is called a geosynchronous satellite. Geo meaning Earth, synchronous meaning at the same time. And what geosynchronous satellites do is they stay directly overhead of one fixed spot on the Earth. How do they spin around the Earth and stay at one fixed spot? That seems confusing. Well, it all has to do with Kepler's third law. By the end of this video, you'll understand exactly what you need to do to launch a geosynchronous satellite. Let's take a look. Let's begin by reviewing our lesson objectives. What are we going to do in this video? First, we'll define Kepler's third law qualitatively. That is, we'll think about it in terms of words. And that'll be pretty straightforward, I think you'll see. Then we'll define Kepler's third law quantitatively. This will take a little more focus, but don't worry, we're going to practice in the third part. We'll practice using Kepler's third law. All right, first up, let's give Kepler's third law qualitatively. Take a look at these different orbital periods of the planets in our solar system. First of all, if you want to know what this means, we need to understand what an orbital period is. Well, an orbital period is the time needed to complete one orbit. And you should know we're going to represent that with a T. So it is represented with a capital T. All right, now let's look back at our chart. Notice the Earth has an orbital period of 365 days, 1 year. Okay, so that's how long it takes the Earth to go around the sun. As we get farther away from the sun, say we go to Saturn, it has an orbital period of 29 years, and Neptune takes 165 years to go around the sun. What we're learning there is as you go farther away, the orbital period increases. That's in fact Kepler's third law. Orbital period increases with distance. So this is comparing different things orbiting at different distances. And as we go farther away, that orbital period is going to increase. But we need to think a little more carefully here about what we mean by distance. So here is our path of the moon around the Earth. And remember that this path is not circular, it's elliptical, according to Kepler's first law. Orbits are elliptical. And ellipses don't have one measure of distance like a circle. They have two. Here are the two axes of an ellipse. Remember, axis A is called the semi-major axis, and the B is called the semi-minor axis. Well, when we use Kepler's third law, we're going to use the semi-major axis, as we'll see in just a minute. All right, now we're able to restate Kepler's third law a little more precisely. First, we just said orbital period increases with distance. Now we're able to say what particular distance. Orbital period, which is abbreviated with a T, increases with the semi-major axis, which is abbreviated with an A. Very importantly, Kepler's third law is comparing orbiting bodies. So Kepler's third law compares orbiting bodies. It doesn't make sense to talk about Kepler's third law unless we're talking about at least two orbiting objects. All right, now we're going to look at Kepler's third law quantitatively. Whoa, that's a lot. I'm going to give you a second just to look at it and be like, ah, lots of numbers, lots of symbols. Don't worry, it's okay, we'll go slow. All right, are you ready? Well, that top row there is just talking about the orbital period of our first object and the semi-major axis of our first object. Maybe we're talking here about the planet Earth. And the bottom row is talking about the orbital period of our second object and the semi-major axis of our second object. Maybe here we're talking about Neptune, which takes forever to orbit our sun. Now, what about all of these superscripts and subscripts? Well, anytime you see a superscript, we're talking about squaring or cubing. So these twos are squaring the orbital period. Meanwhile, these threes are cubing the semi-major axis. The ones, which are subscripts up top, are talking about just the first object. So we're labeling those as coming from the first object. Whereas the twos on the bottom are discussing the second object. We need to put this into practice before you get comfortable, and the way we're going to do that is with a geosynchronous satellite. Here's an image taken by a geosynchronous satellite. You may have seen one of these. It's precipitation, so it's measuring basically rainfall, and it's doing so from pictures taken in space. Here's the thing though, we want to track this rainfall in one fixed spot. That's why we use geosynchronous satellites. The way geosynchronous satellites stay in one spot is by orbiting once per day. So they move around the Earth at the same rate the Earth rotates. Once per day, they go one time around the Earth, and that makes them stay in one fixed spot. How high do we need those geosynchronous satellites to be? That's the topic of our first problem, which says geosynchronous satellites stay at one spot above the Earth's surface by orbiting exactly one time per day, like we just said. Now we're going to be given information about the moon, which may seem confusing, but remember that Kepler's third law always compares two objects. So it says, given that the moon takes 27 days to complete one orbit of the Earth with a semi-major axis of 384,400 kilometers, find the semi-major axis for the orbit of a geosynchronous satellite. Let's go ahead now and solve for the semi-major axis for the orbit of our geosynchronous satellite. Whenever we use Kepler's third law, we should always make thing one the unknown thing. In this case, what we're looking for is the semi-major axis of our geosynchronous satellite. So we'll make that thing one. So thing one is our satellite, and we don't know it. This will just simplify our algebra if we always make thing one the unknown thing. What are we basically solving for here? Is the height of this satellite so that it orbits exactly one time per day. And we're using the height of the moon, the semi-major axis of the moon, to solve for this, which we know is 384,400 kilometers. Then we know the orbital period of our geosynchronous satellite. It's 1 day. That's precisely what makes it a geosynchronous satellite. And for thing two, that's our moon, we know the orbital period is 27 days. All right, now we're ready to go ahead and use our equation. What we want to do is plug in for T1, 1 squared. And then we know we divide that by T2 squared, which will be 27 squared. That's all equal to thing 1 cubed, that's our unknown, divided by the semi-major axis of the moon, 384,400 all cubed. And if we want to get A1 by itself, we need to multiply both sides by 384,400. So let's multiply the right and left-hand side by 384,400. I'm not going to show that on the left side just for space reasons, but we're doing it to both sides. Importantly, both sides are multiplying by this number cubed, so we get rid of that whole thing. And now that 384,400 cubed will show up on our left side, 384,400 cubed times 1 squared all divided by 27 squared is equal to A1 cubed. Here's the tricky part of our problem. We have this cubed thing that we need to get rid of. How do we do that? We raise both sides to the 1/3 power. In your calculator, you'll use a little caret and then 1 divided by 3. And we do that to both sides. That's called taking the third root. And that raising it to the third power will get rid of this 3 and the 1/3. And so on our right-hand side, we'll be left with just A1. Now, when we go ahead and plug this in our calculator, if you do it correctly, you should get 42,666. And I would recommend you try plugging this in your calculator because we have to do 484,400 cubed times 1 squared divided by 27 squared. So you want to practice that. It's a lot to put in your calculator. Now, we want to round for the correct number of sig figs here, and 1 day just has one sig fig right there. So we'll round this to 40,000. So this should be rounded then to 40,000. And the units will be, of course, kilometers. So that's the final answer to our problem. Let's try another problem. These can be relatively tough. This reads, Jupiter has a total of 80 moons. The closest moon, Metis, orbits with a semi-major axis of 128,000 kilometers with an orbital period of just 0.25 days. So Metis is really close to Jupiter and goes around it really fast, 4 times a day. Another moon of Jupiter, Callisto, orbits with a semi-major axis of 1,883,000 kilometers. How long does it take Callisto, which is farther away, to complete one orbit? So we're going to use what we know about Metis to figure out info about Callisto. Remember, the thing that we don't know as much information about is always going to be thing number one. So we're looking for info about Callisto, so we're going to make its orbital period number one. And we're going to say we don't know that. All right, with that little hint and little start, I recommend you pause the video, try to finish this one out, and come back here and see if you get it right. All right, well, let's continue listing our variables. The orbital period of the second thing would be of Metis, which is 0.25 days. Then we have the semi-major axis of thing one. So that, again, is the farther away moon, Callisto, and that's 1,883,000 kilometers, very far away. Meanwhile, A2 is going to be just 128,000 kilometers. You know, I mean, still a pretty long distance. Let's plug those numbers into our equation and solve for the orbital period of Callisto. So T1 is our unknown, and it's squared. And it's going to be divided by 0.25, that's T2, also squared. And it's equal to 1,883,000 kilometers cubed. So that's all cubed, and that's the semi-major axis of thing one, divided by the semi-major axis of thing two, which is 128,000 kilometers, also cubed. Okay, so to get T1 by itself, we're going to start by multiplying both sides by 0.25 squared. Okay, that gets T1 by itself, still squared though, and we have 1,883,000 kilometers cubed times 0.25 squared all over 128,000 cubed. Okay, that's a lot. Now, how do we get rid of that squared? Well, here we just have to take the square root. So that's actually easier than our last problem where we had to raise it to the 1/3 power. Here we're just going to take the square root. Okay, so when we take the square root, we'll get T1 all by itself. And again, this is a situation where you really want to plug this into your calculator. Make sure you get the same thing. You want to cube that big number, square 0.25, divide that all by 128,000 cubed, and then take the square root. You should get 14.1, which will round to just 2 sig figs because our orbital period is 0.25, that has 1, 2 sig figs. So we'll get 14. Now, what are the units here? Well, the units for orbital period that we put in were days, and so the units for orbital period that come out will also be days. Those are always gonna match. And so what we found out is that this really far away moon takes 14 days to get all the way around Jupiter. Let's review what we've learned. First, we defined Kepler's third law qualitatively, where we said that as you get farther and farther away from the sun, it takes planets longer and longer to get around it. Then we defined Kepler's third law quantitatively, where we saw that the orbital period was related to the semi-major axis of our elliptical orbit. And lastly, we practiced using Kepler's law twice. Hey, hey.